And now on the Eurozone budget, you said that countries are stronger, the Eurozone is stronger, more robust. I mean, if we look at the deficit debt levels, so that means that actually the Eurozone countries are doing their homework.
Not all of them, but many more than 10 years ago.
I know, overwhelmingly majority.
Yeah.
So how would you explain to the rest of Eurozone citizens that the countries are doing their homework, but in case of a sudden economic shock that is nobody's fault, they won't have that stabilization function that everybody agrees is necessary, Commission, ECB, Eurogroup presidency, and most of the academies, because of your position?
Not everybody agrees. No. There is a large body of people who don't agree, who say that if, like Spain, you come out of a crisis and you have done tremendous work to get your economy healthy again, you are one of the fastest growing economies in the world, in the Western world at this moment, unemployment is coming down, state deficit is coming down, state debt is coming down, you are doing so much better. And this is necessary because, thanks to that, if there would be a new shock to the system, you will be able to deal with that yourself. If you would not be able to deal with that yourself, there is already an existing European instrument, a European stabilization mechanism. We don't need more instruments to deal with macroeconomic shocks. The best way to deal with a macroeconomic shock is that you have your own country healthy in terms of its economy.
But you mentioned that it's better to have 19 national budgets, but still you belong to an economic and monetary union. So there has to be an economic and monetary union fiscal pillar.
But now I ask you, the Netherlands, because of the crisis in 11, 12, 13, this, the same type of crisis Spain was going through, but of course you had it much worse than we had. But also we had a very tough time. We had to spend, cut 50 billion in government spending and raising taxes. We had our unemployment going close to 10%. It is now on 3.4%. Our debt to GDP was rising to over 70%, now back to 50%. Our deficit was 4 or 5%, it is now a surplus of 1%. How can I ever explain to the Dutch people, how can the Prime Minister of Spain explain to the Spanish people, having gone through all of this, that you are willing to spend money on countries who have not done that, who have not taken the necessary measures and are then calling Brussels saying, hey, I have a problem, could you help me?
But
it's unexplainable.
Spain actually is one of the big champions of the Eurozone budget.
Yes, but I've never understood why. It's not in your interest. Why would you do that?
And do you think that, I mean, given that the Eurozone, the EFSF, was passed during the Eurozone crisis basically overnight, do you think when the next recession hits, that for some people will happen sooner than later, you will ease your position on maybe that Eurozone budget?
I won't.
Never.
No, we have the EFSF. The EFSF was created because we lacked that instrument. So that instrument was necessary. In 2010 it was created. That has then morphed into the European Stability Mechanism. We are now updating the ESM. And today we discussed debt sustainability, single limit collective action clauses. We are working on separating banks and sovereigns. All these things we need to do. But by doing that, you make sure that countries can deal with shocks themselves. And you don't need stabilization, more stabilization instruments at the Eurozone level. With the ESM there, you doing what you need to do. And again, how can you explain in Spain to your citizens that you're going to pay money on country X, Y, or Z, which has not taken those measures, is then calling Brussels. Brussels is calling Spain and The Hague, Madrid and The Hague, to ask for money.
Because that's what it means to be part of the same union.
Part of being part of the same union means a deal is a deal. It means that every part of the union is doing what is necessary to keep the whole strong. Not to say we don't do what we need to do, and then we call the center to help us.
So that never means always never.
I will never support more stabilization mechanisms at the Eurozone level. I do support, and that's now the discussion we are having with the budgetary instrument for convergence and competitiveness. I do support instruments to increase the overall competitiveness of the Union, because I strongly believe that's necessary.
Okay, and a final question. Since you're working more closely now with Prime Minister Sanchez in the context of the top jobs, do you think that that will help to, let's say, ease the differences in when it comes to the Eurozone discussion, not only the budget, but the overall Eurozone discussion?
Of course it helps, and I have the highest respect for Pedro Sanchez, and we work very closely together. I think he's an excellent leader. We do not agree on everything, but we respect each other, and he is simply great to work with, and I trust him. And of course, dealing now with this whole speech and candidate problem and who should fill the jobs, etc., and trying to work with him and Antonio Costa, who are negotiating on behalf of the Social Democrats, and together with the two colleagues from the Christian Democrats and Charles Michel, myself from the Liberals, it even creates a closer bond between us. So it's great fun to work together.
Do you feel that Spain has increased its bargaining power and visibility at EU level? Maybe because of small details like the fact that he speaks English.
Well, I also had the highest respect for his predecessor, and we also worked very well together. Yes, there was always this issue of translation, but maybe I should have learned Spanish before. But maybe it is somewhat easier, but I do have to say that I like him very much. We work very well together, and I hope the best for Spain and for him, and wherever I can help, I help.